As far as science knows, the largest animal that has ever lived is the blue whale. But if you think that means it's the largest living thing in the world, well, think again. There's something a lot bigger, but its life is in danger. NewsHour Weekend's Chris Booker reports from Utah.
Whether you're sitting under its canopy or looking at it from above, it's difficult to comprehend that all of these leaves, the branches, and the trunks that support them are one single organism. What looks like a forest is actually one single tree. Located in Utah's Fish Lake National Forest, the tree spans 106 acres, the equivalent of 80 football fields. But what's up top covers what's happening below, an intricate root system that supports the most massive living thing known to exist on Earth. It's called Pando. The nickname is Latin for eye spread, but the tree is what's known as a quaking aspen clone. That means each leaf, branch, and trunk are genetically identical. Some leaves may be larger, some trunks taller, but if you look at the DNA, there is no difference. Aspen clones of various sizes can be found all over the Northern Hemisphere. There is debate about just how old this tree is. Some scientists estimate that it's existed for thousands of years, but its remarkable longevity is at risk. Pando is starting to die. Professor Paul Rogers is the director of the Utah State University's Western Aspen Alliance. He compares Pando to a human community.
Imagine a town, in this case, the Pando clone, of 47,000 people. But they're all kind of the same age. They're all 90, 100, 115 years of age. And that's no way to sustain a community, be it an ecological one or a human one.
For the past 10 years, he and his colleagues have been working to raise the alarm about Pando's impending demise.
We have essentially a community that's made up entirely of senior citizens. We have no babies, we have no teenagers, we have no young adults, we have only senior citizens, and those are starting to die very rapidly at this time.
In October, Rogers and co-author Darren McAvoy published a study documenting Pando's dramatic change. Using over 70 years of aerial photographs as a guide, Rogers and his team sampled and studied three different plots within Pando to try to understand what may be happening. They found that Pando is suffering a complex ecological breakdown, a disruption that is hindering the way the giant aspen clone replaces the dying portions of itself. A quaking aspen clone like Pando grows not from a seed, but from small saplings that sprout from the expanding root structure. The saplings grow into the white trunks that can stand for well over 100 years, and as older ones die, they are replaced by new green saplings. But there's a problem. The saplings have long served as snacks for the wide array of herbivores, animals that scientists call browsers, that regularly pass through the aspen forests of the Northern Hemisphere. For the majority of Pando's existence, these browsers, everything from rabbit to deer to elk, were not able to linger very long. Predators kept them from spending too much time inside the giant aspen clone.
So historically, if you were an elk or a deer or one of the browsers, the threat would be you are sitting here grazing on a sapling. You could be eaten by a wolf or a mountain lion or a bear.
And that would keep things more or less in balance.
But the number of predators has been reduced dramatically by human-related activities, everything from hunting to development. With nothing to threaten them, the browsers moved in, and Pando wasn't ready.
It's really good when it's damaged or shoved around, its reaction is to sprout. And it's gotten along very well for a very long period with that mechanism. However, when we took away those carnivores and we threw that system off, so now there's too many browsers, now we got a system kind of spinning out of whack.
Because the forest is now a popular recreation destination, hunting is restricted. Also during the summer months, cattle from nearby ranches are allowed to graze in the area. Some parts of Pando have been fenced off, and saplings have started to return to those areas. But Rogers argues fences only address part of the problem and ignore the broader ecological breakdown that Pando's struggle represents.
Now we've introduced some experiments, and we've had at least one good response and one not so good response in these different fenced areas. However, if you multiply the situation across the whole West, and Pando is a microcosm or a laboratory really for the West, we cannot fence all the West. It's difficult and expensive even to fence that 106 acres that is the Pando aspen clone.
Because that's the current temporary solution, if you will, is to get a large enough fence that would surround this 106 acres.
Exactly. So I call this aspen triage. We have a real emergency here. We can throw up fences. I consider fences dumb. It's a simple solution because the more difficult solution involves people with different interests. We've got to get people to come to the table and try to compromise. While we have people who are interested in hunting and healthy deer populations, we have people who are recreationists, we have people that run cattle in that area. So how do we get all these people to compromise, and are we going to be able to convince them that this giant aspen clone, thought to be the largest living thing on Earth at this time, is important?
What happens if we lose Pando?
I think it's a reflection of us. Is this going to come apart during our time? And it's clearly our problem. The finger's pointed directly back at us. And this is a bellwether or a harbinger of perhaps a lot of other environmental or ecological issues.